Good morning.
Morning.
Lights? 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 There you go. There you go. All right. There you go. Yeah. Hopefully my sermon's not like those announcements. Amen? That's good. I want, no, he said, he goes, I set the stage where he said that, so I just say it. Yeah. I wanted to say when he was doing that, I'm not a smart man, but I do know what love is, Jenny. No, I'm kidding. But anyway, remember Forrest Gump, 100 years ago? Anyway, never mind. If you have Bibles, please turn with me to Philippians chapter 4, verse 10. Philippians chapter 4, verse 10. And the title of today's message is Contentment is Learned. Contentment is learned. It reminds me of a story about this guy who was touring an insane asylum. I don't know why you'd do that, but he was. And as he's touring the insane asylum, he goes and he sees this guy in this padded room, and the guy is banging his head against the wall, and he's saying, "Linda, Linda, how could you do this? Linda, Linda, how could you do this?" And the guy says, "Well, what's wrong with him?" And he said, "Well, he married a woman named Linda, and she left him for another man and married someone else." And he goes, "Oh, okay." So then he walks some more, and finally he sees another room. And this guy, another guy, is banging his head on the wall saying, "Linda, Linda, how could you? How could you?" I'm sorry. I can't say a joke to save my life. Anyway, so Kevin, thanks a lot. No, anyway. "Linda, Linda, what happened? What happened?" And the guy says, what's up with him? He goes, "He's the guy who married Linda." People say I get so excited about jokes, I start laughing or freaking out before I give it. But anyway, how many know a lot of times the grass to us in our flesh is always greener on the other side? I think it was C.S. Lewis who said, or someone like him said, that marriage a lot of times and relationships are a lot of times like flies on a screen door. Those who are in want out, and those who are out want in. You know what I mean? So hopefully not us, right? But I've heard of people, right? But we have to learn that how do we know the media, the advertising media is trying to make you discontented? Your car's not good enough. Your house isn't big enough. Your hair's not cool enough. My wife always says to my hair, she goes, it's like, she sees me in the morning, I have it up, she goes, "Ka-ka!" So it's like, always like Rodney King. But anyway, but we need to learn contentment. I'll tell you one thing that has helped me immensely has not been, I got rid of cable TV. And like I told you, to do that, it was like renouncing my American citizenship. But how many know it's been a blessing to my kids? My kids don't always come to me with all the coolest toys they need to have, because how many know when your kids see TV, they see a lot of things, especially right now, right? The newest toy. My kids don't even know what the newest, coolest toy is, okay? And I never forget how cool it was that when my little girl Trinity, my little 10-year-old, was watching TV at her grandma's house, and it was real TV, and it had commercials. She says, "Grandma, something's wrong with the TV. There's these things that interrupt in between the show." I mean, that's pretty neat, you know? And I think we need to get away from that because, you know, how do we know? I tell the kids, don't play on the internet. How many know there's a lot of danger on the internet if you play on it? The internet can be the greatest tool, but it can also be the greatest danger. But there's a lot of things, I'm kind of going off there, but there's a lot of things that are trying to make us discontented. And we need to learn in this day and age to be content in whatever circumstance we find ourselves. Because Jesus said that if you're going to live in this life, you're going to have trials. You're going to have tribulations. How many know that? Amen? That's part of the fall. You know what I mean? There's always, you know, my old Italian family, try not to say it, but I always say, there's always something, right? It's like we fix the septic tank, then the windows break. Then the windows break, then the amp goes out. It's like, man. But how many know I've learned in life that God works through the trials. And a lot of times it's the trials and the struggles that keep me close to Him. Because usually, as I've always said, and you've heard me say it, but it's the truth, usually when we do good, isn't that the time we kind of forget and drift a little bit from God? It's in the hard times we realize how weak we are, how much we have need, and we turn to God. I want to tell you this real quick. What we're going to hopefully learn today is that in the hard times or difficulties or trials of life, rather than turn away. How many know a lot of times when we go through trials, what do we think? I'm going to get a new haircut. Well, that's girls, hopefully. I'm going to buy a new dress, or I'm going to get a new car, guy. I'm going to get a new car, new motorcycle, new something. And how many know after you get those things, they're just another new thing that you got to pay for? But how many know we need to learn our contentment is God? He's what we need. He's what fulfills us, not stuff. And we're going to see that through God, through the Apostle Paul today. So let's pray and ask God to speak to us powerfully today. Father, thank you so much for this day. Thank you for your love. And Father, I pray that we would realize that contentment is not based on our situation as much as it's based on your faithfulness, and much as based on us remembering that you are in control, and that you promise us in Romans 8:28 that God, you work all things together for good to those who love you and are called or given to your purposes. And so, Lord, let us be a church. Let us be a people, old, young, middle-aged, that love you, amen, with all of our hearts, and we're given to your purposes, and you promise that everything that comes our way, everything you allow to come our way, even things that aren't good, you'll turn them for the good in us. So let us see that today. Let us see that contentment is not an outward thing as much as an inward thing. So speak to us, open our spiritual eyes, open our spiritual ears, soften our hearts, and Lord, whatever is needed here today, whether it's conviction for some, whether it's comfort for some, whether it's healing, whether it's deliverance, whether it's change broken off of addiction, whatever need there is today, I thank you that you are able to meet that need. Amen? So Lord, minister to us, touch us, change us in your presence, and speak to us powerfully through your word, Lord. Send forth your powerful word today that will heal us, that will renew our minds in this crazy world. We ask this and we pray this in Jesus' most powerful name. And everybody agreed, said?
Amen.
Amen. Well, at the beginning of the start of Philippians, I said that this letter is a book of joy. Remember, it's the letter of joy, the epistle of joy. Epistle means letter, a letter of joy. But also, I said, this letter is primarily a thank you note. It's a thank you note to the Philippians from Paul. But before Paul got to the thank you part, as we have seen, he's dealt with the Christian experience. He's been talking about the Christian life and how to have joy in the midst of the Christian life. And that the joy that comes from knowing Christ, from spending time with him, from knowing him intimately. And now he's thanking them for, hear this, a financial gift. And, you know, he's thanking them because they gave him, the Philippian church gave him an offering. For 2 years, the Philippian church had lost touch with Paul. They didn't know where he was after he had been arrested in Jerusalem, then put in prison for 2 years in Caesarea Philippi, and the next time they heard that he had been transferred to a prison in Rome. And they were right here, they're apologizing to him for losing contact with him, for not being able to give their offerings and financial gifts to him to help him, bless him during those years. And so Paul is saying, he's basically excusing them in the most gracious way. He's saying, you know what, guys, I know you wanted to give me a gift. I know you wanted to be a blessing, but you couldn't because you didn't know where I was. But here's what he says. Here's his answer to them. Verse 10 of Philippians 4. But I rejoice in the Lord greatly, that now at last your care for me has flourished again. So the giving is coming again. Though you surely did care, but you lacked opportunity. In other words, he says, you Philippians had lost touch with me so that you didn't have the opportunity to be a financial blessing to me and the work that God was doing through me and that God had given me to do. But he's saying, now that you're giving, thank you so much. Thank you so much. And I say thank you to those who give to this work. Amen? Amen? Thank you. Verse 11, Paul says, not that I speak in regard to need, For I have learned in whatever state I'm in to be content. Notice he says, I have learned, not I just was when I became Christian. He says, I have learned in whatever state I am to be content. Hear this. Paul's going to later on say, I've learned to be abound, I've learned to be rich, I've learned to be poor. Remember this, Paul was part of the Sanhedrin. That means he was the Supreme Court judge. The Sanhedrin was 70 judges. How many know, usually judges are pretty wealthy. How many know our Supreme Court judges probably make a decent living? What do you bet? I don't know what they make, but I know it's probably a good wage. And so he was a wealthy man. He was a powerful man, and usually powerful men tend to be wealthy men. And so he knew what it was to be wealthy and then lose it all. How many know a lot of people who have had a lot of wealth and lose it usually freak out? Now, I've heard people say it's not true, but I've heard it is true, so I don't know what. But I heard in the stock market crash in 29, a lot of people jumped out of windows. A lot of people freaked out. I know my grandfather was pretty successful. My great-great-grandfather almost, he felt like jumping out of a window in New York because he was so distressed. But here's Paul, who's had everything and now has lost it, but he's saying rejoice. He's saying, not that I have need. Isn't that cool? How many know, can I say this nicely? And I'm not trying to be a prophet of doom, but if our country continues on the route it is financially, how many know we're going to be in need someday? Yeah. All of us.
You're right.
And so we need to learn this now when we're somewhat blessed to be thankful in and out of season, to be thankful when we're abounding, but also be thankful when things are struggling. Amen? And so Paul's saying he's learned that. Paul's saying that he never made an appeal to them. He never said an SOS for help. And I will tell you this, sadly, sometimes I do. Sometimes, like I told you a couple months ago, when I saw the offering was half of what it was the month before. How many know I can freak out? Amen? Could you imagine if you guys got a paycheck that was half of what you should get? You'd freak out. And I sort of went, guys, what's going on? Did everyone lose their job? And you know, but Paul is so godly, he doesn't freak out. He doesn't say, like those, a lot of the televangelists, if you don't sow your seed faith gift, this ministry is going down. So sow your gift now, right? He didn't do that. He didn't do a pressure give because God, why? God loves a cheerful giver. And I want to say this. Let me say this real quick with this. I don't know if this is going to make sense. I am amazed in life. My son is on the football team at Push Ridge, and they're going next week. If they win the state championship. Yay! You know. And he's a little freshman, so it's kind of cool. See, he does kickoff return. He doesn't get to play a whole lot, but he plays. But I want to tell you this. How is it that in football, that when we discipline ourselves, we call it discipline? We call it learning to work hard. But how do I know in church, if I exhort you to give, or exhort you to be holy, how many know that? Legalism! Have you ever heard anyone in sports say, Coach, this seems very legalistic? Or, Coach, this is sort of being a burden to me. I ask Cannon, when is practice not a burden? Right? Isn't that what a coach does? He pushes you to do things you don't want to do, right? Pushes you. That's what a coach does. How many know that's what I am? I am a spiritual coach to encourage you to step on here, this guys. When I encourage you to give, a lot of you, he asked for giving. You know what I was going to give, but now, nope, not going to do it. But I'm not trying to make you a pressured giver, a discouraged giver. I'm trying to say to you, here's what I'm saying. Hear this, and I mean this with all my heart. Look me in the eyes. I know that if you give in love, you cannot outgive God. I know even if you're hurting financially, I know that in love, you can give out, you can, hear this, you can give your way out of debt. And you go, that got quiet there. This section goes, no. The proverb says, there's one man who's stingy, and even what he has will be taken away. And there's one man who gives, and he'll be even given more. The Bible says, cast your bread upon the water, it'll come back to you. Here's the saying, this is the truth. This isn't some TBN gimmick. This is the truth. You cannot outgive God. But Paul's not begging. He says, you know what? You don't want to be blessed? Go for it. Don't do it. But hear this. I am going to be blessed with or without your gift, but I'm thankful for your gift. And I'd like your gift, but I don't need your gift because God is Jehovah Jireh to me. His provision shall be seen. How many want to live like that? Paul had learned to trust God and to be content in whatever God had provided for him through his people. It didn't matter whether he was in prison or out of prison. You know, many of us think that if things are going right, if we're in a right place or a good place, then we'll be content. Now, if your life is based on being in a good place and everything going your way, then that means you're going to be sad a lot of the time.
That's right.
Amen? I think it was John Lennon who said, life is what happens to you when you make other plans.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Right? Nobody plans on hardship. Nobody says, you know, I want my transmission to go out now. But it happens, right? Nobody says, I want to be driving down the road and have a blowout and then crash into another car. I don't plan that. But those things happen. That's part of life. That's part of living in a sinful world. And if our contentment and happiness and joy is based on those things, of everything going well, then we're going to be sad and disappointed a lot of times. And hear this, I'll tell you this, I know. Because I'm a perfectionist. I like everything perfect. Perfect. I like no glass broken, no nothing. Here's how silly I am. You know those atomic clocks? You know the atomic clocks? Well, I have one that has indoor temperature and outdoor temperature. I'm in the middle of my message, and all of a sudden, the outdoor temperature is not working. And I'm kind of in a rush, but doggone it, I got to get that outdoor temperature because, you know, my phone one, I can't trust it. Can any nut bars out there like me relate? Okay, thank you. One, Ryan Leon. Okay, right here. Hey, Megan, that's why I love you. There you go. But I just want everything to work, you know? I love people who have clocks flashing, like 3 hours off. I can't handle that. I freak, you know? And those of you who can handle that, God bless you. God bless you. You're awesome because I can't. But I like this. Here's what J. Vernon McGee, he's the guy who said, you know, someone said, J. Vernon, can women wear makeup in the Bible? Or as a Christian, he says, if the barn needs paint, paint it. So there you go. I like J. Vernon. Good. Boy from the South. He says this, I have asked the Lord to give me contentment. He had a radio show. He's not living now, but he has a radio show on still. He says, I have asked the Lord to give me contentment. I have prayed for him to make me just as content, tape recording my radio show in my office all alone, as if I were enjoying the beautiful beaches of Hawaii. How many know that's pretty cool? I don't know how nice your office is, but my office is not Hawaii. And he's saying, I want to have the same joy in my office all alone with God doing my radio show as I would in Hawaii.
Yeah.
He said, sadly, our circumstances have a great deal to do with our joy and contentment, don't they? But Paul here learned to be content regardless of his physical location or his financial state. And I want to tell you today that that's something I want to learn. I have not learned it completely. I've learned it at times, but a lot of times my physical state, the broken windows, the low offerings, the septic tank can freak me out a little. Can anyone say an amen to that?
Amen.
And I kind of go, Lord, right? And sometimes rather than turning to God, I actually get kind of mad.
Yeah.
This is what's going to happen. I'm just going to watch TV and just escape. And things get always better when you escape, don't they? And things get every when you watch TV, it always you lift up, you're encouraged, you're built up.
Yeah.
And you should go, man, now I wasted even 3 more hours. I could have been fixing the problem. But anyway,
right.
Anyways. This is radical teaching from Paul, guys. And he says, if you want to be a rejoicing, happy person, then we need to listen to what Paul is saying. And here's what he says, verse 11 again. He says, true contentment is learned. He says, for I have learned, not I just had it when I accepted Christ. He says, I've learned, to be content in all situations. I don't believe that God uses restlessness or discontentment as the primary way or means to show us guidance. You know, I have people tell me, they'll say, oh, people have left this church. I say, so why did you leave? Oh, I just felt restless. I just felt like it was time to go. And I said, well, did God lead you somewhere else? No, I'm still looking. And they've been like gone for a year. How many know that is not God? Restlessness or weariness or the seven-year itch, that is not God. That's your flesh. That's your flesh. Your flesh wants to always move. I love the Keith Green song. Do you remember Keith Green? Anyone out there? Keith Green says this, you could run to the end of the highway and still not find what you're looking for. For what you need is right here. How many know? Jesus is what you need. And if you run to the end of the highway, guess who's going to follow you? You. And a lot of times the big problem in my life is me. Not the world, not the situation, but me. And how many know? How many know people jump out of one marriage into a new one? And guess what? That next wife is just as bad as the first. You know what I love what John Corson said? He said it so well. I had this guy who had been a Christian, divorced like twice in Christ, and he said this. He goes, both of my wives were nut bars, total nuts. And I said, well, okay, I'll give you the first one as a nut bar. But you marry a second nut bar, I think, who's the nut bar? And John Corson says this. Here's what John Corson says. It says in Corinthians that the woman is the reflection of the glory of the man. So if your wife's a stinker, guess what it says about you, man? You're a big stinker. Because she's a reflection. No one's laughing over here. What's this? Everyone? Honey, it's not true. It's you. But we, wherever you and I are working now, we should pray and learn to be content there. We should learn to be content there until God makes it clear that you and I are to move or to change our situation. I'll never forget this. I had a ministry that I started called Say Yes to Life. And we used to do it through the radio station. It used to be where K-Love was. It used to be KGMS. And I used to have a radio show on it. And then I used to go in the schools and I would do a big blitz in the schools. And I would basically share, the scripture in Proverbs, without a vision, the people perish. So I'd do a daytime assembly without too much of God, because you couldn't say too much. And then I would invite the kids to come to like the TCC or the Centennial Hall at the U of A. And we'd have bands like DC Talk or Newsboys, and we'd have a lot of kids. I was on Dobson. I mean, it was a big thing. And so, but with that, I had to raise lots of money because I wouldn't charge the kids for the concert because I felt like someone shouldn't have to pay to hear about Jesus. And so with that, I would have kind of like the TCC, we had Newsboys. I think that cost $48,000 to have the whole thing. We had 7,800 kids, and we had about like, I think, 1,500 get saved. So it was awesome. But I mean, $47,000 is a lot of money. And that was back in like 1993, 1994. But here's the frustration. All of my board was multimillionaires. All of my board were very rich Christians. I mean, each one, the minimum was worth $5 million. Some one was worth up to $850 million. And my budget was only about $160,000 a year. How many know that's a lunch for a lot of those guys? That's a Learjet engine. You know what I mean? I mean, I'm like, no, jet would be more than that. But you know what I mean? I'm going, come on. And they would say to me, we're not going to give to you, Craig. We're going to give you leads, and we want to see how you do before we really help you. Now, I was a youth pastor. You know, youth pastor, you know how Kevin did an announcement? That's how I was with rich people. I'd go into Buck O'Reilly or Jim Click and go, how you doing? And he'd go, how you doing? Hey, you got any money? No. Okay. You know what I mean? It was like, I hated it. I just didn't like being a salesman. I didn't like begging people for money. You love it, don't you, when I beg, don't you? I mean, I see people run from me. Oh, there's Craig Rhodes. And I hated it. So long story short, I quit. I finally said, I can't do this anymore. Well, one of my board members at the time owned, and hopefully you can't figure it out, but he owned La Paloma. Just a small little hotel. And I worked there as a doorman. And I never forget, I'm in there and I went there and I'm kind of angry. I only planned on being there for about 4 to 5 months, maybe 6. And then I would go back into ministry, and I was just kind of doing a little, just to provide for my family. But I wasn't really happy. I was angry. I was mad, at the guys for not supporting me. And I never forget this person, I almost said his name, came up the drive and said, Craig, is that you? And I go, yes, because you didn't give. I didn't say that, but I wanted to, right? I was just so angry. And I went there, and I'll tell you, does anyone have a bad attitude at work? I've heard about people having bad attitudes. I know none of you do, but I had a bad attitude. I remember, how many know it's a tip job? Anyone work a tip job? It's cutthroat sometimes, right? Right? Especially when it's a drive and you have a lot of people rushing for a tip. It's not like a waiter where you know, it's people are rushing. So anyways, so I'm a doorman and I am frustrated and people would just kind of sense my negativity. And then, but they knew I was a Christian, and I never forget this one guy. He used to come here. He goes, Craig, you don't seem very friendly for a Christian. I looked at him and said, you know what? I'm not here to make friends. I'm just here to make money. I mean, that's a great witness, isn't it? I was the worst witness you could ever be. Nobody wanted to talk to me, and I didn't really want to talk to hardly anyone else. And I didn't do well in tips because I was cranky with the people, and the guests can sense when you're not really happy. And then eventually, after being there about a year of crankiness, I don't know, maybe it wasn't that long, but pretty much a year, I realized I'm not getting out of here, am I, God? And it was like, how many know God wanted me there to teach me a lesson?
Yeah, that's right.
He was trying to teach me that you need to bloom where you're planted, and you need to be happy with me no matter where you are. Now, it's easy to be happy when you're in front of 7,800 people and you're on Dobson and TBN's asked you to do a show. It's easy to be happy then. But when you're a doorman, when you go, I had to do when Morgan was in first grade, what does your daddy do? I haul bags from there to there. That's not real exciting, you know? And I just was like, man. But you know what? I realized, so God, you want me to minister here? Just as much as you would like me to minister in front of the TCC.
Amen.
You'd like me to care about these people mean just as much to you as the kids do.
That's right.
And then I started ministering to them. I would hardly make any money because I'd be just driving around at all the housekeeping people and I would just do little sermons everywhere. I would drive my cart and I would be, and they'd say, why were you out with, took you a half hour to take those people to the room? Lots going on the way there. You know, but I would minister, and it got to be where it was like my little church. And it was my church because a lot of times I had to work on Sunday because that's the busiest day of the hotel. But hear this. Here's the point I'm trying to make. Don't work in the hotel business. No, okay. No, here's the point. Is once I said, Lord, if you want me to be here the rest of my life, this isn't what I had. This wasn't my 5-year plan. But if this is where you want me, then I'll be happy to be a doorman for you for the rest of my life.
Praise the Lord.
And as soon as I said that, and I hear this. Now some of you go, is that all I have to say? Okay, I'll get out. No, as soon as I said that and meant it, I was out in a week.
Wow.
And I was there for how long? Teresa said I was there for what, 4 years? It's so painful, I try to say less. But 4 years, that's how dumb your pastor is. 4 years it took me to learn. But I'll tell you, once I left, I was actually sad that I left. People actually cried. My boss who said, I hated you. I wanted to fire you. Nobody drove me more crazy than you. He said, now I can honestly say that I'm going to be sad to see you go. How many know that was God who changed me? And I'm saying that not to boast in me, but I'm saying if God can make me happy in a place that I did not desire to be and there was no prestige, then he can make you happy wherever you are. If you have the Lord, you can be happy wherever you are. Amen. Verse 12, I know how to be abased, humbled, poor, and I know how to abound everywhere and in all things. I have learned both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. Oh, this is a tremendous lesson that we all need to learn because a lot of times the place we're in might not be the most pleasant place to be in. Maybe it's your marriage right now. Maybe it's a relationship with your kids. Maybe it's your job that's not pleasant. I know some of you told me that lately. Maybe it's being single. You're going, oh, Lord. I remember I used to read as a single guy. I was single till I was 31. Lord, Solomon had 700 wives. I just want one. Remember those guys, single guys? You remember them? Maybe it's your financial situation. It's just painful. You don't see how you're going to get out of it or how God's going to see you through. We need to remember that the Apostle Paul was a real person just like us. He had real hopes and dreams just like us. And I'm pretty sure, I don't know his heart, but I'm pretty sure that being in prison was not on his bucket list. You know the bucket list? Remember right before you kicked the bucket? I'm pretty sure that wasn't him. Isn't that crazy? Isn't it amazing how you just go, God, how would you let this happen to Paul? Such a, you know, let him, you know, he wrote 2/3 New Testament. How would you let this guy go to prison and suffer and struggle in jail and then die? Why? Wouldn't you think, you know, if you were God, you'd say, no one touches Paul. But God's ways truly are not our ways, amen? Because he knows that is what took to make Paul the man that we love, that see Christ in him. And how many know, a part of us when we say, God, I want to be like you, you know what we're asking for? La Paloma. We're asking for a little bit of hard times because it's in the good times that we forget the need for God. We are truly like sheep and we go astray. We again need to remember that he's telling us here that he learned contentment. It wasn't just put in him. He learned contentment. While he was in a prison cell, he chose joy. When he was in prison, he wrote this letter of telling the Philippians to rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice. Let your forbearing spirit be made known to all men. The Lord is what? Near. That's the key. Not if you're in the Lord like TBN, everything's going to go well. No, he says even in prison, the Lord is near. Remember I told you a long time ago about those women that were arrested in Afghanistan. I think it was Afghanistan. But anyway, somewhere like that. And they said they had memorized all this scripture and they're all ready for persecution. And they said all the scripture kind of fell away. And they said what really touched them was Jesus reminding them in their hearts, I will never leave you nor forsake you. I'm here with you. And they said that's what comforted us when we thought we might be raped, when we thought we might be killed, when we thought who knows what's going to happen. It was the fact that God was with us. And that's what Paul says. Rejoice, the Lord is near. And isn't it amazing? When you're hurt and frustrated, what does he try to do? He tries to pull you away from the Lord, doesn't he, the devil? How could your God allow this? If God is a loving God, why did he do this? You ever heard those things? But he learned contentment in prison, in one of the harshest. In a prison, hear this, guys. You're not sure about prison. Our prisons would be like the Hilton to Paul today. The prison cells were cisterns in Rome. The Mamertine prison was a cistern. It was where they'd cut out a big hole and they would literally have to lower the prisoner, drop the prisoners in, and they had levels of the cistern. And what would happen is if you were in the death cell, it was the lowest cell. So that means all the waste, all the urine went into your cell. So basically his cell was an outhouse. So picture that. There was no cable. There was no TVs, there was no books, there was no law degrees to be gotten. It was just total suffering and torment. But yet he rejoiced. Isn't that amazing? Isn't that amazing? Do you ever just try to really picture that? I always love to picture this. I read the Fox Book of Martyrs every once in a while. And do you remember the thing where Caesar Nero, who is arresting Paul, but Caesar Nero would light Christians on fire? Remember that? He dipped them in tar. He'd light them on fire at his palatial gardens, and he'd light Christians, strap them to poles, and light them on little kind of up in the air, and light them on poles. And then he would joke, and he'd play his violin. He'd say, "You are the light of the world. You are the light of the world," mocking them. But the Christians would sing praises to God as they're burning alive. And it is said that he would freak out and he'd literally start screaming and screech at the demons and he would start screeching and he'd have to leave because he couldn't take the praises to God. I don't know about you. I don't really want to be lit on fire, but I'd like to be able to overcome evil like that. Amen? Amen. Amen. To where I'm not going, oh, where's God? But I'm saying, praise God. God is good. Even when things are not good, God is still good. He learned this as he wrote this letter, chained to a Roman guard 24 hours a day. They said they would change the guard every about 6 to 4 hours. You'd get a new guard chained to him. How many know this? Look at you guys. Look at you guys, guys. How many of you love to be right next to someone you don't know? Look at you. Hey, excuse me. Right? They say in churches nowadays, they used to say you need about 80% or 20% space rule. You know, if you have 100 seats, you're only going to fill it about 80 because people can't be crunched unless there's a revival. How many know? We like our, hey, back off. Can you imagine someone just clinking to you, a guard? You know, you could, how many know that could make you a little cranky? Going to the bathroom with a guard chained to you? Do you mind? But he chose contentment. And the proof of this, that we know he was content, is because of this. Verse 22 of this chapter, Philippians 4. He says, and all the rest of God's people send you greetings too. Especially, listen, those in Caesar's household. So do you hear what he's saying? He's saying those guards that I was chained to, those La Paloma workers that I was chained to, they came to know Christ because guess what? I had a good attitude. Because guess what? When I had a bad attitude, not one of those people said, hey, how do you have such a bad attitude? I don't know how to do it like you. Tell me about Jesus. I want to tell you this, guys. Hear this. A lot of times I'll hear people at our church and I'll say, hey, you know Ted? Well, Ted goes to our church. He's a Christian. And people go, what? Ted? He's a Christian? I mean, that's not a good day for me as a pastor. But it's really a good day when I say, hey, you know Ted? You work with Ted? Yeah. No, he's a Christian. Oh, that makes sense. I always wonder why I had that goofy smile all the time, even when the boss is mean. The proof that Paul was content in prison is that he actually was a mighty witness for Christ, even in the worst prison ever. He was so, like Jesus, so given to God that he could, instead of saying, you know what, I shouldn't be here. I am falsely accused. This is so wrong. He was saying, hey, you know what? You kind of have to listen to me, don't you? I'm going to tell you about Jesus. And that was so, Paul was such a different person to them that they said, you know what, I want that. How can you be in prison falsely and be joyful? How can you see God in the midst of this? And we know, again, that he said what? He said, verse 11, I have learned in whatever state I'm in to be what? Content. And how many know, I'm going to tell you this, some of you might be in some really bad states, but you're not as bad as Paul. Amen? None of you live in an outhouse, do you? No? Some of you go, my son's room's close. The problem with most of us is that we're thermometers rather than thermostats. We're thermometers rather than thermostats. A thermometer doesn't change anything around it. It just registers the temperature. It's always going up and down with the climate or with its surroundings. I mean, that's a lot of us. Amen? Think about us as Christians. Yeah, what do you think of that? What do you think of our president? What do you think of that? No, I'm not saying that you should be happy, but I'm saying, you know, we just kind of... But a thermostat changes its surroundings. A thermostat, it changes surroundings when it needs to be changed. And sadly, as I said, most of us are thermometers, and the climate around us changes rather than Christ in us changing our surroundings. I want to be a thermostat, amen? I want to be so filled with the Lord that I'm not saying denial that things are hard, but I'm saying that greater is Christ who's in me than he is in the world. I want to say that, you know what, even in the midst of this pain, even though my boss might be treating me wrong, God is still good and in control. And I'm going to choose joy and contentment over grumbling, complaining, angry, and almost... Because think about, when you're really grumbling, complaining, who are you really complaining to? If you're a sheep and you're saying, man, my life is terrible, it's worthless, it's terrible. Who are you indicting? The shepherd. But this was not so with the Apostle Paul. He was a thermostat. Instead of having spiritual ups and downs all the time, like you and I a lot of times, instead of being regulated by whatever situation and very bad situation he was in, he would let Christ in him change the situation from a negative one to a positive one. I love this. Even the Cardinals football team has on their wall, better is a positive something than a negative nothing. Amen? And let's be real. Have you ever been really negative? And you know, especially if you're a single guy, right, and you're walking around, I don't have a job. Girls just flock to you, don't they? Don't you, when you're a negative person, people just, whoa, okay, there's Craig, whoa, you know? They just run from you. But if you're a positive person, you're a joyful person, people just go, hey, let's just hang out. Isn't it funny? The time when you want encouragement, people don't want to be around you. The time you're happy, you don't need people, they want to be around you. One in which he saw, you know, this positive that he saw in Christ, that he saw Christ in his situation, and that Christ was still in control of his life. And hear this to prove this. It's Ephesians 3:1. He says, "I, Paul, am a prisoner of Christ." Notice he didn't say, "Hey, my lawyer worked me." You know, I don't know if you remember Shawshank. Oh, well, only leave my lawyer, you know, messed me up.
Yeah.
Can't say the word, but you know, my lawyer messed me up. Paul said, "What? I am a prisoner of Christ. Jesus has me here. Not Caesar Nero, not the Jews. Jesus has me here." And I want to tell you, when you realize that God is sovereign, now here, can I just say this? This is a little side note. Most of our problems is because we're not walking with God close and we put ourselves in bad problems. But if you're walking close, if you're obeying the Romans 8:28, that God works all things together for good to those who what? Love him and are given or called according to his purposes. You love God and you're given to his purpose, then he promises all things work together. If you're doing that and your situation isn't self-induced, then God promises he will let you, if you'll let him, see joy in the midst of it. See that he has allowed this, and because he's allowed this, he's going to give you the strength to endure it or go through it. Amen? At the close of this letter, Paul indicates that he was not a victim of circumstances, but a victor over his circumstances. And that's what I want. I want this. One of my favorite verses is Romans 12:21. I like this verse. It says, "Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good." How many want to live like that? I don't want to just be ran over all the time by the evil in this world. I want to be Christ greater. As Christ was in us, I want to let Christ in me overcome the obstacle or the evil that's trying to discourage me and trying to forget God. I'll tell you this, church. We need the Lord. We need an awakening. We prayed, I told you last Friday, not this Friday, but the Friday before last, we started praying here. And the Lord just, first time we just wept and everyone was crying. It was amazing. This Sunday, everyone's kind of was sick. And so our prayers weren't as intense. And I kind of got discouraged. You ever get discouraged? You get excited about something, a party for someone or something. And everyone's like, yeah. It was like that time. I go, man, Lord, we get excited for 1 second. Then yeah, back to the old ways. How many know God wants us to awaken? God wants us to be excited. God, not just so hyped up. I'm talking really joyful to say God is in control. God is in control. And how many knows? I heard someone say this. Hear this. Someone said, "You know what? I hope God brings revival, but I don't know if he's going to." How many are going to pray for that if you're sure that's, if you're thinking that's the way God is? I don't know. Maybe he will, maybe he won't. Do you know the Bible says, and the Lord reminded me when that person said that to me, because I went, maybe I shouldn't pray anymore. The Lord said to me, Hebrews 11:6, that without faith, it's impossible to please God. So how many know when we go, I don't know, I don't think, or Obama's messed it up too much. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. Because anyone who comes to him, it means pray, must believe that he exists. Do you believe he exists? Yeah. But here's the key that we forget. And that he rewards those who diligently or earnestly seek him. So I was saying to these kids, they go, man, this is really, last week's sermon, you were really on fire. You weren't usually your boring self. It was awesome. And I said, guys, when you seek me, you will find me. When you search, so it can keep going. It doesn't have to have one peak and then, oh, we're down now. Now the roller coaster is going down. How many know it should go like this? From glory to glory to glory. Yes. Not that we'll never have mellow times, but it shouldn't be up, down, up, down, 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 up, down. I want a lot more up than down in my life. And here's what I'm trying to tell you. The downs are not based on who's in the White House. The down is based on how much you have faith in your God. Or the up, I should say. Sorry, it's not the down. How the up is that you know God is greater than the White House. And that every awakening did not start in the White House. Every awakening started in grassroots of people like you and I.
That's right.
And no one can stop you from loving God.
That's
except you. No one. And that's what I realized when these kids were kind of going, Lord, thank you for this day, you know, praying. I realized, you know, that's a little bum. I wish they could, you know, suck it up and take some emergency. But you know what I realized? No one can stop me from being excited about God. No one can stop me from saying God is good even though things outwardly might not be perfect. No window can steal my joy if I choose to realize that God is in control and God rewards those who diligently or earnestly seek him. Verse 13, maybe you've heard this verse before. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Ever heard that verse? Yeah, we all claim that verse. Here's what J.B. Phillips translation says. Philippians 4:13 says this. I like this. I am ready for anything through the strength of the one, Jesus, who lives within me. How many like that? I'm ready for anything through the strength of the one who lives within me. Another way of saying it is this. Not just I can do, because that makes it sound like I can do anything. You can't do anything if it's not God's will, right? But he says, I can endure, one person says, all things through Christ. God will give you that endurance, that hupomone, that patient endurance to go through trials with joy, including being content even in your prison, even in your hardship. Either we as true Christians believe this, or we can choose not to believe it. Either way, either we say, Lord, let this truth be true in me, or not just evident in the Apostle Paul, but let it also be evident in my life as well. Amen? Whether or not we choose to learn this contentment that we can have in Christ, the choice, hear this, is yours. You, as the old Pentecostals say, you can make a choice to rejoice. Amen? Think about this. What did Paul say? Remember what Paul said? Oh, my soul, why are you so discontent or downcast within me? He's saying, what's wrong with you? And he says, put your hope in God, for I will what? Yet praise him. Do you hear that? He's saying, soul, shut up. Stop it. God is better than how you feel, and rejoice the Lord. And hear this. I was telling the kids this. Hear this, guys. This is free. This is all free. Hear this. We think if I don't feel like praising God, that's hypocrisy, don't we? Well, I don't really feel like it. My daughter used to say, I can't say I'm sorry if I don't feel it. Hypocrisy is when you praise God and you really don't love God. That's hypocrisy, right? When you say, I don't love you. I don't care about God. I'm just doing it to look in front of people like a Pharisee. But hear this. The Bible calls what? When you praise and when you don't feel like it, he calls it a sacrifice of praise. When you go, everything inside me, my, you know, like the man, remember the hymn we always said? It is well with my soul. He wasn't going, it is awesome. I love, these kids were a drag. I am so happy. He said, this hurts. I'm sad. But I know God is in control. So it is well with my soul. And I'm going to praise you. And I'm going to praise you as Job did. Remember, he says, the Lord gives. We all love. Did you know one big church in town here changed that song? The Lord gives and gives some more. Because they didn't want to say the Lord gives and takes away. How many know that's a false gospel? Because the Lord sometimes takes things. He allows things to be taken. But Job says, are we going to only praise him in the good times, woman? I mean, it's easy to praise him in the good times, but we need to praise God even in the times when he allows things to go, when we're not healthy, when we lost our job, when our kids are sick. It's our choice. I love this. One comedian said it this way. I don't know if you heard of Tim Hawkins. He says, he was joking about a Southern preacher. He says, content or discontent, which tent do you live in? You know, you have to ask yourself, what tent do you want to live in? And if you want to live in discontent, you'll be alone in that tent. But if you choose contentment, you know, you'll have a happy home and you'll have a joyful, you'll be someone that wants to hear about your Jesus. Because they see, wow, you have every reason to be discontented, to be angry, to be sad, but yet you're content. And what's your boast? Because of Jesus. It's because of Jesus. No matter what translation you prefer of that verse, Philippians 4:13, they are saying the same thing. A true Christian has all the power within them that he or she needs to be adequate for the demands or the pressures of life. We only need to release this power, hear this, by asking and trusting Christ in us to say, God, give it to me. Fill me. Help me to rejoice. Help me to see you in this. Jesus taught the same thing in John 15. He said this in the Sermon of the Vines and the Branches. I'm going to paraphrase it to go on because I am behind. Here it is. He is the vine, Jesus, right? We are the branches. Any branch, a branch is good only for bearing what? Fruit. But if it doesn't bear fruit, otherwise you what? It might as well be burned, Jesus said. Thrown in the fire, burned. That doesn't sound good, does it? The branch that does not bear fruit through its branch does not bear fruit, he's saying, by its own effort, its own desire. But it only bears fruit by drawing its life and strength from the vine, from Jesus. Amen. Jesus said what? Apart from me, you, talking to Christians, can do nothing. You can't endure anything on your own. You are weak, but he is strong. The Bible says in Ephesians 6:10, be strong in the Lord and the strength of what? His mighty power. You and I need to put and tap into him and say, God, I am a weak sheep. Please help me. And he'll give you that strength. Do you ever see an apple going, oh God, I want to be an apple. All he does is abide in the vine, and the vine and the roots give it strength to be a red, delicious apple, a fruitful apple. Does that make sense to you? It's not working it up. Isn't like the Pentecost. I'm not catching a cold. I'm catching a healing. When you have snot pouring out your nose. It's saying God is in control. God is good. And I will yet praise him even though I don't feel like it. Because I know I love him and I'm given to him and his purposes. And I know he's going to work this hardship for good to those who love him. And I love him. As we as believers maintain this communion with Christ, the power of God is there to see us through the hardest difficulties. Can I ask you a question right now? I want to ask you right now. How many of you could say you're kind of going through a difficulty right now? Raise your hand humbly. Yeah, look at that. Over half the congregation. We need Jesus, don't we? Amen. Not just saved. We are saved, hopefully. But we need to tap into the power of the vine. Abide. Notice it says abide. That means to dwell with, to remain with, to live with. Not just come on Sunday, but live with him throughout the day. Throughout the day. You don't have to turn there, but if you're a note taker, write this down. 1 Timothy 6:9. I'm almost done. I want to ask you this. How many of you have clothes? Did anyone come naked today? We've had some girls come naked. I want to tell you a story. I want to tell you a story, but I won't. But anyways, I better not. My wife will give you a look. I better not tell you. It's a good story. I just don't want to take up the time, and it's going to throw it off. I always have a way of making a special moment of clothes weird. But anyway, but here it is. Most of you have clothing, right? Maybe not the most designer clothes, but all of your clothes. None of you came naked. Did anyone have food today? Did anyone have food? Do you have food? I mean, because people say, oh, I have nothing to eat. How many? Nothing to eat is when you only have one thing to eat. People who are poor, we have food. And we're going to really eat a lot of food this Thursday, right? Enough for the week, right? But hear this, guys. Here's what Paul says in 1 Timothy 6:9. So if we have enough food or clothing, let us be content. Do you see how the media has made you feel discontented? I never forget when I rented a really nice Suburban. I have a Pilot. I know my Pilot was great until I rented the Suburban. Notice this. We always say, my house is too small. My car is just a Pilot. But Paul says, if you have food, you have clothing, be content. Amen. So here's my thing. Paul would say to you, wimps, stop whining. Because you all have. A lot of you have a lot more than that. That's right. And he's saying, you have every reason to be content. Because if I can be content in a jail cell, you can be content at your job.
Amen.
You can be content in your marriage. You can be content because I am with you. Does that make sense? It's a choice. And it's a choice. And I'll tell you this, sometimes we have to maybe don't look at the commercials, right?
That's right.
Don't look at L'Oreal. You deserve it. Because
oh, yeah.
You don't. Do you remember when remember when women actually had hair like mine? Yeah. I love what you see. I love when you see these old guys. I see these pastors that were gray, and all of a sudden they have jet black hair, and they're 80 years old. Amazing. Would you guys notice if I did that? I'm thinking of one day just putting that washout stuff, put it in there. How you doing? Thank you very much. You know? But let's make a choice. Let's make a choice to be content because God is in control of your life.
That's right.
Amen? Let's pray. Father, thank you so much. Thank you for your goodness. I thank you for what you're doing in our lives. And Lord, we're to thank you for all things, but we don't thank you for broken windows. We don't say, thanks, the window's broken, but we say, thank you that you're going to work it out. Thank you that you allowing this is working you and me. It's working a choice to rejoice. It's working in me to free me from this world and to prepare us for eternity where we're not going to have, where we can just say, you know, it's all about you. And so, Lord, I truly pray for everyone here, as you said, help us, Lord, to be in this world, but not of it, Lord. Not that we don't care about windows, not that we don't care about our job, not that we don't care about our kids, but that we realize we see you in the midst of the storm. We see you in the midst of the struggle. We say, okay, God, what are you doing? And then we say, God, like Job, the Lord gives, and it's easy to worship you then. But Lord, I also want to worship you when you take away or when you allow things to go or allow things to not go the way I want. I want to be someone, and I pray for everyone here, that we're not so controlled by our circumstances. We're not victims of circumstances. We are with you more than conquerors through Christ. We are victorious over our circumstances, and we see you working in those hard circumstances to make us more like your Son. Thank you. That is not just a cute saying, rejoice. As Paul said, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice. Let your forbearing spirit be made known to all men. The Lord is near. Let us always remember that we never go through anything without you and that you care. Remind us of like when Paul, when he was Saul and he was persecuting the church, you said to Saul, 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 why are you persecuting me? Jesus, you identify with us so closely that when Paul was persecuting Christians, it was as if he was hurting and beating you. Let that be so in me. Let us realize you're that close to me. When someone hurts me, it hurts you. I pray that that truth would touch us deeply today. And that we could say like Paul, I can endure all things through Christ who strengthens me. Let us abide in you that we might always be connected to the vine that gives us strength. Father, I just want to say this real quick. Just say this with me if it's you. Father, forgive us when we're severed from you throughout the week. Forgive us for the times we'll go a whole day without touching your word. Amen. Forgive us times we go a whole day without praying. And then we wonder why we've ran out of strength. We wonder why we're angry. We wonder why we're frustrated. We wonder why we're not content. It's because an apple doesn't do very well broken off from the tree. It starts to get squishy and mushy. So Lord, let us reconnect with you right now. Amen. To say, God, we want to be back connected to you, the vine, the power source, the source that gives us strength to endure. Bless your people right now. Anyone who's been away from you, draw them back right now. To say, God, I've been a fool. I've been foolish. I thought I can do this life without you, and I'm sorry. And show us it's not enough just to be saved. We need to learn to abide and dwell and live with you throughout the day. Take you wherever we go. In Jesus' name, amen.